各位师长，各位同学，大家好，我是暨财系一九级施佑京，很高兴能担任本次专题演讲的司仪。演讲即将开始，请尽速就座。在此提醒您，请将手机关机或调为震动，以免影响演讲的进行。谢谢。Ladies and gentlemen, the ceremony is about to begin.Please take your seat in the lecture hall. Meanwhile, may I remind you to switch off your cell phone or turn it to a silent mode. Thank you for your cooperation. Jerome Friedman 教授及贵宾们 Ladies and gentlemen, please give a warm applause to the Vice President for Research and Development, 潘希林 Dr. Jerome Friedman, and distinguished guests.演讲开始前，感谢贵宾、师长和学生们今天的参与。Before we start, we would like to thank all the distinguished guests, faculty members, and students for coming. Let's cherish this magnificent moment together. 首先，介绍今天的与会贵宾。Also, please allow me to introduce you. 诺贝尔大师 Jerome Friedman 教授。Nobel Prize winner, Dr. Jerome Friedman. National 清华 University, Vice President for Research and Development, Professor 潘希林。今天的主持人，国家理论科学研究中心朱创新主任。Today's host, Director of Research Division of National Center for Development, Professor 朱创新。今天的逐步翻译老师。国立清华大学物理系张维甫教授 Today's interpreter, National 清华 University, Department of Education, 张维甫首先请潘希林研发长为我们致辞 It is our great honor to invite Professor 潘希林 to give a welcome remark 研发长请
欢迎各位来参加今天的诺贝尔奖大师在清华的活动。Friedman 教授是关于基本粒子实验研究的大师。各位可能知道，基本粒子呢是组成物质的不可分裂的一个元素。其实古今中外都有无数的人想要知道说到底组成这个宇宙的最基本的要点是什么，所以很早就有所谓的在东方和西方都有所谓的五行理论啊，所谓金木水火土。那么在西元五世纪以前，在印度和希腊就开始有人提出来说，所谓的原子 是这个不可分裂的最小的一个元素。那么后来到了亚里士多德的时候，这个集大成。在希腊文里面，原子这个字字的意思就是说不可再分割的。可是到了十九世纪末二十世纪初呢，我们科学家们发现说，原子事实上并不是不可分割的，那么它由这个电子和原子核所组成。之后由于分析的进展，我们能够发现说原子核里面事实上有质子和中子。那么更进一步的话，Friedman 还有很多物理学家就发现说，其实质子里面还有更基本的粒子，就是所谓的夸克。那今天那个Friedman教授会跟我们分享关于他发现夸克的经验。那么这是利用非常高能量的加速器发出这个高能量的电子束或者是质子束，让他们和物质碰撞或者是互相碰撞，然后分析产生的结果。大家知道在2012年的时候，所谓的神的粒子 Higgs particle 被发现。那么最近新闻有报道说在 CERN 其实他们有真相显示说还有更重的粒子可能存在，所以好像这故事还没有结束。那各位今天来参加这个演讲的话，我想除了可以亲自Professor Friedman 他的大师风范，同时对于这个重要的领域能够更加了解之外，如果大家看一下 Professor Friedman 他的经验的话，他在中学的时候实际上是念所谓的美术班，所以他对绘画是非常有独到的这个成就的，他实际上有开过画展。可是他在中学的时候并不是他有广泛的兴趣啊，所以根据他说呢，他看了一本有关于相对论的小书，然后就对物理有兴趣了，所以在大学的时候就开始念物理啊，然后就一直钻研这个到底是什么物质的构成的基本元素这个重要的议题。那也许各位会觉得这个跟我们距离的很远，可是现在很多医学和我们健康有密切关系的这些设备，事实上用到很多加速器的技术啊，比如说可能各位听过所谓正子的这个摄像 ，OK， 这就是其中的一个例子啊。好，那我想我就不多说了，接下来我把麦克风交给今天的主持人，朱尚新教授。好，谢谢大家。
Thank you very much, Professor Pan. Please stay. 现在，请研发长颁赠纪念品给 Jeremy Friedman 教授，请以热烈的掌声欢迎 Jeremy Friedman 教授上台。This is a warm applause to welcome Dr. Jeremy Friedman to come up to the stage.请 Jeremy Friedman 教授留步。Thank you, Professor Pan. Please return to your seat. Dr. Jeremy Friedman, please stay. 现在让我们掌声欢迎今天的讲者 Jerome Friedman 教授。Now, let's give a round of applause to welcome today's speaker, Dr. Jerome Friedman.
I'm very sorry. 不好意思，有一个重要的 announcement， 先跟大家先讲一下啊。欢迎，当然是欢迎今天来的贵宾，各位老师、各位同学，来参加这个很有趣，一定是很有趣的一个演讲。那我们为了增加这个同学参与的这个程度呢，我们准备了一些特别的礼物，等一下。演讲以后，一个发问前五的同学可以得到邓肯教授他亲自签名的海报，很有纪念价值。所以大家用心听，用心问，有一天你可能也会站在那台上来跟大家签一个海报。So I think we can pass the mic to you now. Let's welcome Professor Friedman.
Thank you very much for the kind introduction. It's certainly a great pleasure and honor to speak to you today. And today I'll talk to you about how the most fundamental objects in the atom, along with the electrons, were discovered. And, you know, all of us, everything around us, is made of three fundamental things. Up quarks, down quarks, and electrons.And this talk will give you an idea of how physicists came to this conclusion.
Okay. 很高兴今天能够来这边给演讲。那其实大家可以看一下收到的这个东西呢，基本上只有用三种东西构成，是所谓的上夸克、下夸克跟电子。那今天这个Friedman教授就要告诉大家这个发现是怎么被导出来的。
First of all, what I want to talk about is the fact that scattering experiments have been utilized to find the structure of particles and the atom in particular. And Ernest Rutherford started the great tradition of modern particle physics in scattering experiments.In the early 1900s. And so let me give you an idea of what we're talking about. Imagine I gave you a fishbowl, but I gave it to you in a dark room. And I asked you to count the number of fish in the fishbowl. And I told you, you could not put your hand in the fishbowl.You'd say to me, that's impossible. But then if I gave you a flashlight, you'd say, oh, that's trivial. I turn on the flashlight and look. And so I have a beam of light, I have an eye, and I see the fish. You know, particle physicists do exactly the same thing to see what's inside of particles. Instead of having a light beam, they have a particle beam.And because of quantum mechanics, particles have a wave nature just like light. And therefore, you can establish images. Instead of having the eye, I have electronic detectors. And instead of having a brain to assemble the image, I have computers programmed by human intelligence. So that is the basic process of looking inside particles to understand their structure.
我们怎么去研究这个物质的 次结构呢，在二十世纪初呢 ，Rutherford 开始了一系列非常著名的那个 scattering 散射的实验。那Friedman 教授这边给了一个例子呢，就是譬如说在暗室中如果有一个鱼缸，如果在暗室中的话，然后又不准你用手去摸，那你当然不可能说知道里面有几只鱼。但是要是在这个房间里面，他给你一个手电筒的话，那就非常简单了，你就打开手电筒。那从左边进来的就是光波，然后你的眼睛就可以看到有几只鱼，这基本上就是我们视觉告诉你有周遭环境怎么样。那现在如果要换到这个加速器的话呢，因为量子力学告诉我们物质都是一种波动，所以波动基本上跟光是没有什么差别的。那现在这些鱼呢，基本上是我们想探索的次物质的结构。OK， 那我们就把眼睛换成现在的 detector。一个侦测器 ，OK。那我们大脑去收集这些视觉信号，告诉我们有几只鱼。我们现在变成用 computer 去换算这些散射的资料，这些波动散射资料，告诉我们里面有什么东西。
So here is the first experiment in modern physics utilizing scattering. It was a very simple experiment. There was radium, which is a radioactive source.It emitted alpha particles, which are the nuclei of helium, and they scattered from a gold foil, and there was a zinc sulfide screen, which you observed optically, and that was it. And it turned out that the alpha particles scattered at large angles, and this experiment alone was able to determine the basic structure of the atom.
1911年呢，这个拉塞福他最著名的散射实验呢，他的这些 setup 他这些setup 就跟我们刚刚跟刚刚的这个鱼缸的比喻没有什么太大的差别，所以我们现在把手电筒呢换成这个 alpha particle， 这个 alpha particle 是从这个放射性元素雷发射出来的，然后它经过一个开口之后呢，这个 alpha particle 可以走一条直线，它只选这个直线部分。然后这个 alpha particle， 大家知道什么叫 alpha particle 吗？就经过一个晶箔，然后发生散射。这晶箔就像刚刚的晶鱼一样，然后它再跑到一个硫化锌的礼物上，它会有闪光发出来。这样子你就基本上可以就重复或是应用我们刚刚这个鱼缸这个比喻来做散射实验。
Large angle scattering, and I'll show you why that was so important.Because in those days, there were two competing models of the atom. There was the so-called plum pudding model, which was proposed by J.J. Thomson in 1904. And in that model, of course, the atom has both positive and negative charge, equal amounts. And in his model, the positive charge was scattered all over the region of the atom.And the electrons were inside like plums in a plum pudding. And so that was his model. And the other model was the solar system model by a Japanese physicist by the name of Hantaro Nagaoka, also in 1904. And in that model, the nucleus, there was a deposit charge within a small nucleus in the center of the atom, and the electrons went around it. Now, the fact, you see, in the top model, if you have an alpha particle coming in, when it's outside the region of the atom, it sees neutral charge, so it doesn't scatter at all. It only scatters when it gets inside, and if it gets inside, it would scatter from an electron. However, the alpha particle is 8,000 times heavier than the electron. So imagine a truck hitting an 8,000-pound truck hitting a 1-pound stone, the truck is not deviated. It just goes straight. However, in the other model, the solar system model, all the charge is in the center. And that center is 50 times heavier than the alpha particle, so that the alpha particle could bounce off at a large angle. And so if you saw large angle scattering,The solar system model was the model. Now, physicists We're very unhappy with that result, okay? And that's why that this model was rejected initially. And the reason for that was that in classical physics, if you have an electron going around a nucleus, it is radiating all the time. And the atom would collapse in a very short time by basically giving up all its energy. And the actual time that it would collapse in was 10 to minus 10 seconds, roughly, of that order factor. So basically, all matter would collapse. And in terms of it being a viable system. And the reason that that ultimately was accepted was because of quantum mechanics. Quantum mechanics fixed that problem. And that's and this model, and this theory, this experiment, required the invention of quantum mechanics to keep the atom stable.
Okay. 在拉塞所做这个实验的时候呢，那时候市面上有两种原子模型，一个是上面看到这个梅子葡萄干固定模型，在这个模型里面呢，这个正电荷跟负电荷是很均匀分布，OK，所以没有所谓的原子核，所以在正电中心都是均匀的分布在这原子里面。那你用这个阿帕利口去打它的话呢，因为阿帕利口很重，它是两个质子两个重质。 那刚刚啊，那教授用比喻就是开一个巴顿的卡车冲过去，那比如说你撞了一个小时的话，那对卡车来讲一点影响都没有，卡车就一直很开心的往前面跑，这是这种固定模型可以预期的结果。OK， 那刚刚在拉塞普实验啊，散射实验里面呢，一个重点就是它做了大角度的散射测量。那大角度如果会有一些大卡车会被用很大的角度返弹回去的话呢？ 基本上是支持下面一个所谓太阳系模型，这是由一个日本人那个兰高考他提出来的。那不过当初在古典物理里面呢，这种模型是不被大家接受的，因为如果大家记清华大学有修过电磁学的话，你就知道这个东西呢会很快的放出同步辐射，反正带电粒子如果被加速的话就会丢出辐射，所以它能量一下就丢掉，所以。 如果在古典系统里面呢，这个模型能够存在存活时间只有10的负10秒，大概光跑1公分的距离，这原子就毁掉了。那拉塞普这个大角度散射实验除了验证这个太阳系模型之外呢，也提供一个量子力学很重要的起源。我们需要量子力学来解释为什么原子在这样的模型里面可以非常的稳定。
Here's a picture of Rutherford on the right and his student Hans Geiger on the left. And you can see in the center is the apparatus they used, right? It's a very small apparatus, but it was this apparatus was used to discover the structure of the atom. And it's quite tiny compared to the gigantic detectors that we build today to study particle physics.
是1912年，这个拉塞福在 Manchester 大学的实验室照的照片，右边是拉塞福，然后你可以看到那时候的做这个实验的仪器有多少，它基本上可以放在桌上。那等一下大家可以看到现在高能物理的实验室的 scale 有多大。
And of course, now that the atomic nucleus was discovered, the question was what did it consist of? Well, it turns out that the proton was discovered in 1919, and Rutherford had concluded that the proton must be the nucleus of the hydrogen atom. And the neutron was discovered in 1932, and therefore it was proposed that the nucleus consisted of neutrons and protons. But the question was, are they fundamental particles? What I mean by that, were they made of other particles or just entities unto themselves?
随着这个实验的进展呢，大家就发现其实原子核事实上是由这个质子跟中子所构成的。质子在1919年由这个拉塞福发现，1932年是这个查德瑞克发现中子。那接下来问题就是质子跟中子是不是最基本的粒子？意思是它还是 它底下有没有更次更精细的结构来组成质子跟中子。
So we, the modern tools for doing particle physics are particle accelerators, particle detectors, and scattering experiments to actually, as I said, uncover the structure of particles and the structure of the forces, and also to produce new particles that were, existed in the very, very early universe.
Okay, 那在现代我们有很多比较现代的工具可以来研究次原子的世界。第一个就是我们有粒子加速器，可以把粒子速加速到很高的能量，那这个光波就比较短，所以你可以看比较小的这个系统。另外一个呢是我们的 detect 侦测器的技术也有长足的进展，所以我们等于有比较好的眼睛，可以看得更清楚到底一只鱼还是五只鱼。另外我们有很多很多的这个散射实验。那除了探索这个粒子的结构之外，包含它们的交互作用力，也可以在这些实验里面看出来。另外呢，在加速器里面，因为能量很高，温度很高，所以你也可以模拟宇宙早期开始时候的这个状态。我们可以甚至可以把研究推广到早期宇宙。
Now the point is, I want you to understand is that particles are very powerful.Microscopes. And why is that? In order to see an object and study it in great detail, with light for example, the wavelength of the light must be much smaller than the object you're examining. So, and of course that is equivalent to getting high magnification because you're examining smaller and smaller particles. Now the point is,Particles, as I told you, have a wavelength. But the wavelength depends upon the energy of the particle. So lambda, the wavelength of a particle, is equal to Planck's constant, don't worry about that, divided by the momentum. And as the energy goes up, the momentum goes up. And so that is why physicists want higher and higher accelerators to examine smaller and smaller objects.You see, if I look at the nucleus with a low energy beam, you see the object on the left. If I increase the energy significantly, I can see the object on the right, and I can start seeing the details of the structure of the nucleus in terms of neutrons and protons. And of course, that's why an electron microscope is much more powerful than an optical microscope.
那粒子加速器基本上大家可以把它想象成一个非常功能非常强大的这个显微镜，那就像电子显微镜一样，光波呢，它受限于它的波长，那你要能够看到更小的结构的话呢，基本上你就要用波长更短的东西。那量子力学告诉我们呢，这个物质都基本上它都是一种波动，这个波长呢，浪达呢，基本上是 Planck constant 除以它的动量，那动量越大的话呢，它的波长就越短，你就可以看到越细小的东西。那动量越大的话代表能量越大，所以在高能实验里面为什么叫高能实验，就是因为我们需要产生比较高能量的这个色素粒子素来探索这个或者是提供比较短波长的波动去看这个磁结构。 OK， 那这边有一个图系，在波长比较长的时候看到是一坨不知道什么东西的结构，但是你如果用放大倍率比较高或者是波长比较短的这个显微镜来看的话，你可以看到右边的这些结构。
And to give you an idea of the magnification required to study various scales of matter, for example, we start out with bulk matter, the chair, we have magnification 1. If we want to study the atom, we have to increase the magnification by 100 million.Then if we want to study the nucleus in detail, we have to have an additional magnification of 100,000. And then if we want to start studying quarks in neutrons and protons, we have to have an additional magnification of 10,000. And this is why you need higher and higher and higher energies, bigger and bigger and bigger accelerators.
所以这个图示是说，如果你眼睛的视力放大倍率是一的话，你可以看到一个椅子的话呢，你需要有一亿倍的放大倍率，你才可以看到原子的结构。你需要另外十万的倍率呢，你才可以看到原子核里面有质子跟中子的存在。然后呢，你又再需要一个一万倍的放大倍率呢，你才可以去研究质子中子里面的结构。所以这时候你才能够看到质子中子里面的光。
So I want to talk about the developments in particle physics after 1946, after World War II. There were new high energy accelerators developed, new synchrocyclotrons, new types of detectors, bubble chambers, and scintillation counters. I don't have time to discuss these. But the whole point was, because of these new, this new technology,